Okay, so everything works good. So welcome everyone. I would like to give you a basic idea about the astronomy in the Czech Republic, and this is because the GAIA summer school is held in Brno in Czech Republic. So I think you should have at least a basic idea how it is in with astronomy in Czech Republic. And I have to say that this will be a strongly biased view, because other people could mention other research, could mention other people, other scientists, and other topics. So I would like to say sorry to everyone who will not be mentioned, and whose research will not be mentioned. So, if you come in person, you would need to travel to Czech Republic, which is the country in the heart of Europe. It's a small country. We have about 10 million people. 10 million people live in Czech Republic, and we have lots of historical monuments here, and this is because at the medieval times, Czech kings ruled a significant part of the Europe, and also later, in 16th, 17th, 18th century, we were a part of Austria-Hungarian Empire. So we have lots of historical monuments, lots of castles, lots of churches, monasteries, and so on, but we also have lots of natural monuments. The borders of Czech Republic are created by mountains, so we have beautiful mountains. They are not so high. The highest mountain is 1600 meter above the sea level, has the top 1600 meters. So they are not high, but they are very, very nice and beautiful. And I think that all of you heard that Czech beer is our specialty. Actually, we brew the most beer in the world per capita, and we also drink most beer per capita in the world. I don't know if this is something we can be proud of, but to be honest, I like beer very much. So if you come to Czech Republic, you will definitely taste Czech beer. And when speaking about Brno, Brno is the second biggest city in Czech Republic after Prague. Brno has about 380,000 citizens. During the school, this number increases to almost 500,000, because there are five big universities in Brno and many, many more private universities. So I think I can say that Brno is the student city. And I'm sure you would appreciate its family friendly atmosphere, because it's a quite compact city, and you can basically walk everywhere you need. Again, there are many historical monuments. You can just walk a street, and I think that you will ever find something new that you have never seen before. This actually happens to me every time I go to Brno. I notice every time something new. So Brno is a very nice and friendly city, and if you get the chance in future to come to Brno, I really recommend it. The biggest university in Brno is Masaryk University. It was founded in 1919. It has currently 10 faculties. Last year it was only 9, but this year, faculty of pharmaceutics joined Masaryk University. There are 400 programs you can study, and there are about 30,000 students who study at this university. And we have 7,000 graduates every year. So this is the second biggest university in Czech Republic after the Charles University. And the Department of Theoretical Physics and Astrophysics is part of one of these 10 faculties, so the Faculty of Sciences. We have about 50 students of all degrees, bachelor, masters and PhD students, and 8 core employees, but many more external employees. Here you can see the courtyard of the campus, and here's the building of the physics, and I'm currently sitting here in one of that windows. So I cannot greet you, but at least this way. So something about the research here at the department. We are mostly interested in stellar astrophysics, in stellar atmospheres and stellar winds. Many people work on variable stars in general. There are people who are interested in binaries, in pulsating stars, in CP stars, chemical peculiar stars. People here are also working on stellar systems like open clusters. Some people are interested in developing new methods and tools for data analysis. Since this year, also high energy astrophysics is present at this department, or maybe I can say two years ago already it was partly here, but since this year it's here, let's say, full time. Also history of astronomy, and we provide and maintain some databases. For example, our LIRE stars, the Blaschko effect, there is a database for open clusters and chemical peculiar stars, so we maintain a few databases. Actually, SuperWASP survey is now stored at our servers. Just to mention the papers with the most cited papers from our colleagues from this institute are these three. So you can check them. These are really interesting works. For example, this by Norbert Werner. They discovered that the metal content of the intergalactic medium is higher and was enhanced. Must be enhanced about 10 billion years ago. So very, very interesting work. You can see on these pictures the observatory. It's placed on one of the hills here in Brno. This is actually the public observatory and planetarium. And here in this dome, you can see it here, is our biggest telescope. It's a 60 centimeter telescope, which was built in 50s of the 20th century. Then we use also 35 centimeter Schmidt-Cassegrain telescope. And since 2010, I guess, we also use the 1.5 meter telescope at La Silla, the Danish telescope, for the photometry. Good. But Brno is not the only institution which is focused on astronomy, which is doing research in astronomy. The most important, I think, the most important institution is the Astronomical Institute of the Academy of Sciences, which is on this map here. There are about 100 researchers at this institute. Then there are two universities, one in Opava, in a quite small city with 50,000 citizens. There's Silesian University, and the biggest university in Czech Republic, Charles University, is placed in Prague. There is also Astronomical Institute. People in Czech Republic in general deal with basically all topics, all fields in astronomy, starting from the sun, from the solar system physics, from the interplanetary matter, and going from to stars and from stars to galaxies, and the cosmology. So basically all the topics are covered. And we are also involved in a few space missions. For example, the most current is the Solar Orbiter, and people from the Astronomical Institute are involved in this mission. We are also involved in the Plato mission, in the future missions, Plato, Ariel, Athena, and so on. We are also participating on the large ground-based projects. Opticians from Czech Republic built the mirrors for the Pierre Auger Observatory in Argentina. So the coverage of all astronomical and similar topics is, I think, very, very broad. On this map, you can also see some binoculars and some moons. Every such symbol means that there is an observatory. So, as you can imagine, astronomy is really popular in Czech Republic, and there are lots of public observatories in Czech Republic. We also have three reservations of dark sky. So I think astronomy is quite popular in Czech Republic. One of the most famous fields that the Czech astronomers are good in is searching for meteorites. In 50s, Zdeněk, I forgot his name. Zdeněk Ceplecha started to build a fireball network, basically using wide field cameras with some moving segments, and from triangulation they were able to trace and find the meteorite just from its track on the sky. And from that they can rebuild and reconstruct the whole orbit of such bodies. So Czech people are really good in this, and I think that two-thirds of all meteorites that have been found on the ground were found by Czech astronomers, or at least they were involved in searching for these meteorites. So I think that's the most significant part that Czech astronomers are good in. And Pavel Spurný, that's the man at the Astronomical Institute who continues in work of Zdeněk Ceplecha, and he's spreading out the network, and they also managed to do a network in Australia, which is shown here in this picture. So if we are speaking about astronomy in Czech Republic, I have to mention a few people and to introduce you a few people. These two men are not Czech. They are not origin in Czech. That's Tycho Brahe and Johannes Kepler. At the end of 16th and the beginning of 17th century, they lived here and worked here in Czech countries, on the courtyard of Rudolf II. Tycho Brahe was probably the best observer with naked eye, and Johannes Kepler formulated his two Keplerian laws in Prague. Tadeáš Hájek z Hájku, he was the personal doctor of Rudolf Druhý, but he was also astronomer, and in 1572 he observed the supernova in Cassiopeia and speculated that the idea of a non-changing sky, which was formulated by Aristotle, is not valid anymore. This is William Herschel. His family, his parents or grandparents, I'm not sure now, they come from Czech Republic, or from the place that was in the area of Czech Republic. Here you can see, this is already 20th century. This is Antonín Bečvář, who made a famous atlas of the sky with the famous charts with stars up to 7.5 magnitudes. So the, his atlas was also used from in by astronomers in the whole world. From my point of view, the most famous astronomer of the 20th century is Zdeněk Kopal. He was really enthusiastic man because he joined the Czech Astronomical Society in his 15 years, and when he was 16, he was he started to be a chair of the section of variable stars and exoplanets. And during 3 years, he made 10,000 observations of variable stars. If you ever observed visually the variable stars and compared the brightness of the stars, you know how tremendous amount of work it is. And he graduated at the Charles University, and then he got a stipend in Cambridge, and he worked under Arthur Eddington. And a year after that, it was 1938, he got a stipend in the US and worked with Harlow Shapley. So I think it's very, very interesting and very admirable. He taught astronomy in Harvard and other institutions. He became a head of the astronomy in Manchester University. Actually, he never came back to Czech Republic because of the World War II and then because of the communism, because he was an unwanted person here. And probably the most important of his work is the work on close binaries and the theory of the mass transfer in close binaries. I checked the citation number of his book from 1959, and it has almost 1,000 citations. It's incredible. Okay, the next one who can be mentioned is Ivan Hubený. He works on stellar atmospheres. He also works abroad. He's working in Canada, and he made a lot of models. Maybe you know Tlustý model of stellar atmospheres. Then here you can see Luboš Perek. This year he is 101 year old man. He was a general secretary of the International Astronomical Union at the end of '60s of the 20th century, and he is the one who built the 2-meter telescope in Czech Republic. Then I should speak about these two men. They are scientists who made the astronomy very popular in Czech Republic, Dr. Jiří Grigar and then Professor Zdeněk Mikulášek, who is working at our institute. They wrote lots of books, and actually books by these two men brought my attention to astronomy, so I would like to thank them both. We have two ESO ambassadors who made the astrophoto, Petr Horálek and Zdeněk Bardon. So I'm sure that there are more people who could be mentioned here, but this is my personal choice. In Czech Republic, there is a Czech Astronomical Society, which was founded in 1917, so during the First World War. Actually, it was established even before the International Astronomical Union was founded. It unites about 550 members. It has 8 local organizations and 9 specialized sections. And I will speak here about one section which is the most active, and it is a section of variable stars and exoplanet of Czech Astronomical Society. There are about 80 people. Most of them are amateur astronomers. And this section maintains very important databases. For example, O-C gateway, which contains about 250,000 times of minima of eclipsing binaries. This is the most extended database of this kind in the world. We also maintain or the people in the section of variable stars and exoplanets, they maintain the Czech V catalog, which now contains almost 3,000 new variable stars that have been discovered by Czech observers. This is also, I think, a very nice result. And the most important ETD database, exoplanet transit database. This database is used basically everywhere around the globe. And when I was in the US last year in the autumn, the people knew this database. And now it contains about 10,000 transits of 360 exoplanets. There was a journal, Open European Journal on Variable Stars. I've been the technical editor of this journal between 2015 and 2019. It was kind of survival of this journal, and it has been ended in 2019 because I had no time to work for this journal. But luckily, people from the Department of Theoretical Physics and Astrophysics, namely Miloslav Zejda and Ernst Townsend, took the responsibility and renew this journal. So now you can again submit your papers to this journal. The biggest telescope in Czech Republic is the 2-meter telescope, which is now named after Luboš Perek. It's placed in Ondřejov, near Prague, about 30 kilometers to the southeast of Prague. And it was built in 1967, and it has been used for optical spectroscopy. And since this year, when the telescope was modernized, the optical fiber was used to feed the spectrographs, and since this year also photometric mode is available at this telescope, which is in full operation. And people at the Astronomical Institute are mostly interested in physics of hot stars, of BE stars, of binaries, newly also in GRB outbursts, and there is also a group which deals with exoplanets. And because I'm a part of this group, I will show you a few results that we got. The group around Peter Kabat deals with validation of exoplanet candidates. This means that we are doing echelet spectroscopy with the Ondřejov echelet spectrograph. You can see part of it here. And we are getting the radial velocities of the host stars. This is quite a difficult task, because you need to measure radial velocities with very, very big precision, because you are dealing with velocities less than 1 kilometer per second, typically. Here at this graph, you can see the number of clear nights, also in percents. It's from 2015, but it's more or less the same every year. So here you can see that the best observing conditions are in August and in March. That's basically for the whole Czech Republic. So about one third of the nights is available. And here you can see how we perform. Last year we published a paper where we made some tests of the Ondřejov echelet spectrograph. And in bright stars, we can get the scatter of about only 80 meters per second, which is, I think, very nice result. And we can observe hot Jupiters and these big exoplanets. One of the results we got is the discovery of a very interesting star. Actually, the motivation for observing this star was this dip. It was an exoplanetary candidate in the databases because of this transit. And the automatic routines that process the data from K2 in this case, they completely remove this light variation because they are considered as some trends or something like that, some artificial things. But we try to model this system, and we found that it's a A star with two solar masses and an M dwarf, which is just grazing. It's not a full eclipse. And here you can see the radial velocity curve that we got, and it appeared that it's a chemical peculiar star, and we interpret these changes as a consequence of presence of chemical spots on the surface of the A-type star. What is even more interesting is that we found that the A star is pulsating in a delta Scuti regime, and it's probably the first such star that has been observed. We are still gathering new data, spectropolarimetry and such kind of observations, and this system is really interesting because it seems that there is a third body, and probably we were wrong because these changes are probably not from the spots but at the primary but at one of the other components. Another interesting result is the discovery of the first brown dwarf observed by TESS. Here you can see the radial velocity curve. These blue points come from the Ondřejov echelon spectrograph. The amplitude is about plus minus 4 kilometers per second. And here you can see the TESS data. Interesting on this system is that it's probably the first brown dwarf observed in a system with a metallic A-type star, which means that this star has some chemical peculiarity. Some elements are overabundant, some are underabundant. And the interesting thing on this system is that we actually don't know how it was formed. Because the orbit is circular and it's a very young system, it's about 180 million years old only. So there was not enough time to circularize the orbit via the tidal forces. So it's very likely that this brown dwarf was formed in situ in this system, on the place where it is now, which is interesting and could put some constraints on the formation of brown dwarfs. And I will, at the end of my talk, I will show you some slides with Ara Lyrae stars, which are stars that I really love. These stars are pulsating horizontal branch stars. Here you can see the HR diagram of a globular cluster, and they are placed approximately here on this place at the horizontal branch. Because they are old, they are very useful as tracers of metallicity, and they are used as distance indicators and used for testing stellar and evolution theory. So very important stars, which can tell us something about the formation of the old systems like a galactic halo, or let's say the whole our galaxy and other stellar systems. And there are basically two mysteries. One of them is the so-called Blaschko effect, which causes modulation of the light curve. This is something which I was dealing and I'm still dealing with the Blaschko effect. And actually there is no explanation of this. And the second mystery is the lack of binaries with Ara Lyrae component. We now know about 400,000 Ara Lyraes in various systems, in our galaxy, in Magellanic clouds, in global clusters and so on. But there is only one strong candidate for binary. If you check this plot, it shows the incidence rate of binary stars among various spectral types. And if we consider that the progenitors of our Lyres, because our Lyres are already evolved stars that already passed the Regine branch evolution and settled on the horizontal branch. So if we take these stars of G type as a progenitors, you should still observe something about 50% of stars to be in binary. So why there is only one binary in this system? So it is probably connected with the evolution, because if this star passed the red giant branch evolution, it means that we are searching for very wide binaries with very long periods, and it could only be observational bias, but we don't know yet. So if you want to observe binaries with Lyres, you are experiencing real troubles, because you need long-term monitoring and monitoring which is quite precise. Fortunately, there is a way how to overcome this how to identify stars that could be in a binary system, and this is through the light travel time effect. Because if you measure some times of a clock, just imagine a clock that is moving around some center of mass, around something else, and you can just calculate when the tick should appear. And if it's moving, then the light travels to you, and when the clock is the most far away from you, then the signal would come later, and vice versa. So if you observe some cyclic changes in period, then it could mean that this star you observe is actually in binary system. And this offers chance to model the whole orbit. So you can get the full orbital solution from that. And there are a few tens such candidates. Unfortunately, these changes are very, very long. You can see it's in the order of years or decades. So here you can see the majority of known binary candidates and their periods. It's in logarithmic scale. So you can see that the periods of the known candidates are very, very long. And to make the situation even more difficult, in 2018 we found a system or the star that shows really nice cyclic period variation. But the problem is that the resulting mass of an unseen component is about 56 solar masses, which means that it must be a black hole. And fortunately, in this star we also had radial velocity measurements, and we could show that in radial velocity variation there is nothing basically. So there must be some internal period variation, some phenomenon that causes change of the pulsation period in cyclic way, and it's not due to light travel time effect and binary. So it's very likely that lots of the candidates that have been identified by the period variations are actually not in binaries. So the only way how to discriminate between candidates and real binaries is by radial velocity measurements. But it's very problematic, because you need to observe for years, and imagine that the variation of the pulsation causes changes in the radial velocities of about 50 kilometers per second. So you need to really measure precisely for a long time to discriminate between candidates and real binaries. So this is just to show you some interesting results. As I said many times, it's my personal selection of interesting things regarding the Czech astronomy. And with this, I will end my talk. But before that, with GAIA, there's another option how to identify these binaries, and it's through the common proper motion, or if you observe that the stars that are very close to each other on the sky, that are in the same distance, but they are moving completely different, that could also mean that they are binary candidates. So thank you for your attention. If there are any questions, just notify me or write your question to the chat, and thank you for your attention.